Okay, so the last section I'm going to talk about as we wrap up the this lecture on George Leonard's mastery book is going to be pitfalls, things that we need to look out for on our path to mastery. And the first one is going to be conflicting way of life. So the traveler whose main path of mastery coincides with career and livelihood is fortunate. And I talked about this in the last excerpt, is that most people aren't going to have the luxury of starting off on a path of mastery and making money at it. They're either going to have to start before they have kids and family and careers, or they're going to have to do it later or after. But if you're trying to do it while you have those obligations, it's not that you can't do it, but just think about how exponentially more difficult that is. You need to make a lot of time, and that time's going to take away from your family, from your wife, from your kids. And how are you going to find that time? Now, I know guys that get up at 4 a.m. and they study for 2 hours, 4 to 6, and then the kids get up and they help get them off to school and everything, and then they go to work. And they do an 8 or 9 hour day at Blizzard or something. I'm thinking of one guy in particular. Then he comes home and then he squeezes in, you know, hangs out with the kids until they go to bed. And then he has to squeeze in another hour or two. When's he gonna see his wife? Where's the productive relationship time? When are you gonna squeeze a workout in? Lunchtime at work, probably. You know, it's tough. It's really tough. So these are the challenge. This is the real marrow of what we're talking about. It's all, you know, marshmallows and unicorns until you have to sit down and grind it out, and then it's the real deal. So others must find outside or regular work for preferred practice. This will be many of you who are attempting to pursue the arts as your main focus. So I've worked with thousands of individuals in this situation. I've seen many people work through it, but man, it takes a really concerted effort. So all the more necessity to pick a good course of action as time is scarce and of great necessity. If you are in that position, you don't have time to waste with bad education, poor education. You need to find a better instructor. You're gonna have to probably pay extra for them. And something like, again, go online and use me as your mentor. Use Eric as your mentor. You might say, well, that's just too expensive. Well, then maybe learning art's going to be too expensive. I don't know. You know, I'm not saying we're the only option, but there, you know, the old saying, it takes money to make money is definitely true. You have to invest. Now, a lot of people just want everything for free and, you know, hey, why can't you just teach me, you know, I can't believe you have to make money at this. You can't be a really good teacher for that. Huge sacrifices are made, right? So we just have to, you know, it is what it is. If you want good instruction, you'll probably have to pay for it, and it's going to be hard to find. That's just kind of the way it is. But it is out there. So those options are, but if you're in that position, you're going to have to invest in a better course of action. Otherwise, the chances of making it are almost minuscule. So it takes me to an old saying, how do we allocate our scarce resources in order to, in this case, time and money, in order to satisfy our many needs and wants? I think that's the only thing I can remember from an economy class is supply and demand and that saying that I just said, which are really two of the biggies. I mean, it's really comes all down to that, it seems like. So we need to get clarity and focus and stay on the path. We don't jump around, you know? Try to stay consistent. We can find time, the national average. Okay, so I talked about the national average being 7 hours of TV a day. Now, you may not be that kind of person, but maybe you watch 1 or 2 hours a day, which would probably be more nearer to the case, I would imagine. That's still 2 hours, like I said earlier, that you can focus into a concerted course of action for your mastery. So we talked about that. In order to follow the path of mastery, you're going to have to sacrifice. Sacrifice is going to have to be made. Okay, so remember the Henri quote, great art is a great life lived, living at the highest level of your faculties at all times. So this is a little bit of redundant, but okay. Number two is obsessive goal orientation. So we just talked about conflicting ways of life. We have obsession goal. Okay, so cultivate modest expectations at every step along the way. The Zen saying goes, keep your eyes on the path, and when you reach the top of the mountain, keep climbing. I love the Zen guys. They always just throw the parables and the spins and it's wonderful. Surrender to your teacher, but only as the teacher, not as a guru. Okay, so don't stick with a situation, teacher or school that is not working for you. I talk time and time again, yeah, I'm in this program and I don't really like it and I'm having to teach myself and it's costing me 70 grand a year. I'm like, what are you doing? Why are you in that program? Why are you teaching yourself for $70,000 a year? The teacher should be giving you structured exercises, should be helping you, working on your work, demoing in front of you, making your paintings look good, telling you why it doesn't work, showing you. If they're not, it's a waste of your time. best to cut ties as quick as possible, I think. That's just my opinion. Number three, poor instruction. Oh, that's what we were talking about right now. Sorry, poor instruction. So don't bounce from one teacher to another. If you find a good one, which are rare, stick to them like gum on their shoe. I mean, if you can. I mean, whether it's online or in actually brick and mortar, if you can find a group of instructors that are willing to make you better than them, then go there, right? Go there and spend time until you tap them out. Remember, the responsibility for your getting a good instruction lies not with your teacher, but with you. It's your responsibility to be a good student, to show up, to be attentive, to show the instructor that you're passionate about what they're teaching, and to help them help you, okay? So don't expect them to do all the heavy lifting for you. They can show you the way, but you're gonna have to do, obviously, the actual path itself. So lack of competitiveness. I thought competitiveness was a bad thing. No, it's really good. Competition, good, can produce motivation. Take competition as an opportunity to hone our hard-won skills to a fine edge. So competition allows us to practice what we've learned in a competitive environment in order to push ourselves to higher levels. So we don't need to think, you know, most of the people that have an issue with competitiveness don't know how to compete, in my opinion. They don't know how to lose gracefully. They don't know how to win gracefully. They don't normally come from a hardcore background of athletics and things that taught you that when you were very young, how to gracefully lose, how to, you know, still move on after injuries and work through hard things. So they always say, oh, competition's evil, because maybe they had a bad experience with it and they pulled away from competitiveness and never, I'm not going to compete because it's evil and I don't like, it's a wrong way to look at it. It's really a poor way to look at it. So let's see here. Winning is an essential element in the master's journey, just not the only thing. Winning gracefully and losing with equal grace are the marks of a true master. Okay? So over competitiveness. So we have lack of competitiveness, and then we have over competitiveness. The old saying, winning isn't everything, it's the only thing, is one of the greatest hoaxes of all time, according to George. If winning is the only thing, then practice, discipline, conditioning, and character are nothing. Right? And we just talked about all those things being everything on the path, and that the path itself is the reward. The path itself is the satisfaction. The byproduct of being on a path that's satisfying like that usually is monetary compensation. It usually is those kind of things, because they're a byproduct of doing things at a high level that you love. It's almost like the law of returns. I mean, you can't not succeed if you're doing that. It's very difficult not to. So laziness, number six. The definition pretty much sums it up. Disinclined to action or exertion, adverse to labor, indolent, idle, and slothful. So laziness is defined, will definitely knock you right off the path. So the good news is the path is the best possible cure for laziness, but it takes courage. So we have laziness, we are aware of laziness, all of us procrastinate and lazy at times. If you're gonna be lazy, then be lazy 100%, just own it and go into it deeply, feel it, be it, and then it usually will just pass by. But if you feel guilty about being lazy and then you start thinking about it, can kind of keep you in that state longer. So one thing I would say is just surrender to it. If you're feeling lazy, then be as lazy as you possibly can, and it'll soon pass, and then you can go back to being productive. But laziness will clobber you if you have a tendency towards it being an issue. Injuries, number seven. So even though we're talking primarily about art, applying this book to art and studying, like we talked earlier, there is still runs a risk of injury. So a good example is I just had a young guy come into the school. He was coming from the East Coast and he was going to move here, and he was coming out of a very expensive school that he decided wasn't working for him. So he was going to move here and study with us. And so he was so excited about coming out. And I talked to him about, I don't know, 2 months before he was coming out for the next term. And he started training like 13 hours a day, crazy, because he wanted to show up and he had got it, you know, his pride and competitiveness in front of it. And he really wanted to come in and kick butt and do really good. And he was excited. It was mostly out of a sincere excitement for coming out and studying with us. And he trained so hard that he completely destroyed his hand. I mean, he ended up with really bad tendonitis in the elbow and in his wrist. And so he's trained his left hand and did the same thing with the left hand. So he comes in with these two, like, I don't know, the kid looked like he's got all these things strapped on him and hands. And he couldn't make it through the first term. He had to quit and go home. So that's a perfect example of just not playing your edge, not well, not understanding your limitations, not understanding the balancing act between rest, stretching, working, learning, and not taking the true master's course. Although his enthusiasm was that of a master, or would give him the impetus, he was an obsessive, which we talked about earlier in the course. He obsessively lost track and ended up hurting himself. Okay, so he played his edge, and he's going to learn a lesson from it. And I hope he's young, he's in his early 20s, he'll come out of it and be fine. But it was just a perfect example of what we're talking about. So surpassing previous limits involves negotiating with your body, not ignoring it. Surpassing previous limits involves negotiating with your body, not ignoring it. So negotiations require awareness and experience. In order to make good decisions, we have to be aware of our own limitations. You know, I got a bad knee, or I shattered my knee as a kid, and now I have to baby it, or I have to know its limitations. You know, so as you go through life, you're going to have injuries, especially if you're an athlete, and you're going to have to learn to work through them and around them and not just surrender to them. But that does not mean just, you know, pounding your way through them all the time, which is what my old mode of operation used to be. Negotiation requires awareness. Okay, so I encourage 2 or 3 hours of drawing or painting broken up with some sort of physical activity, walking, running, going to the gym, yoga, lifting weights, whatever. Mix it up also in that area. So that's an art that you'll have to learn on the side, which is working out and all that. So you'll probably need a trainer, and you'll have to do a similar thing. It doesn't have to be quite as fanatical as your main focus, but it should also be done properly. Everything should be done properly. So, and then after that, you take a little break, you come home, grab something to eat, and then you do another 2 or 3 hours in the evening. So a good 6-hour day is plenty. I think that's an incredibly productive day for an artist. Think of it as a part-time job. So do 20, 30 hours a week if you can. I know that's hard for most people. I also encourage gentle stretching throughout your 3-hour work session. So every 45 minutes or so, set a little timer for yourself. Take a 5-minute break. Stretch your fingers. Stretch your arms in a doorway. Stretch out your shoulders. Do some neck stretches. There's a bunch of these that we can go through maybe at another time as a small, short, just kind of a YouTube teaser or something. Our stretching exercises for artists or something. I'll probably do something like that. Number 8 is drugs. Okay, so if you are on drugs, you aren't on the path. Simple as that. Boom. You know, it's an easy one. Prizes and medals. Excessive use of external motivation can slow and even stop your journey to mastery. So excessive use of external motivation, having to have accolades, having to make money, having to be rewarded for everything you do. These are things that are warnings. Prizes are, and accolades are great. They can remind you that you're doing a good job, and that, but don't let it go to your head. This too will pass, as the old saying goes, the old Zen saying. No matter how good it is, it'll pass. No matter how bad it is, it'll pass. Everything passes. So when you win an award, great. But like my dad used to always tell me, you're only as good as your last effort. Only as good as your last effort. Every painting you're working on, every drawing you're working on, that's the only thing you're going to be remembered for, is that piece you're working on right now. Not the 50 great ones you did before, and all the wonderful book covers, and all the wonderful movie posters or concepts, storyboards, whatever it is you hang your hat on. You're only as good as your last one. You know, you're only good as your last one. I thought that was it's a hard way to look at it, but it's a really realistic way to look at it. A lot of times you guys are going to say, God, this guy is just such a hard ass, you know, just so intense. And it is, I'm just telling you the way I've experienced it. It's my experience. It doesn't mean it's going to be yours necessarily, but I do believe there's a lot of truth in it and a lot of honesty. So the ultimate reward is not a gold medal, but as we have alluded to the whole time, is the path itself. Prizes and medals, great. Got to make a living, fine. But at the end of the day, the path is your reward. Okay, so there you go. Vanity number 10. You have to be willing to look foolish. If you are always thinking about appearances, you can never attain the state of concentration that's necessary for effective learning and top performance. So if you, and again, some of you might want to break, like my wife's been going through a lot of this lately and been working on herself, and like I am as well, my whole life, we're life learners. And she really is trying to break through old patterns and limitations and things that have you know, kept her limited in certain ways in her life. And so she's breaking out and she's doing these wonderful things that are stretching her way past her comfort zone and way past anything I've witnessed since I've been with her. And I've been with her for 25 years. So she's going and doing Toastmasters and, you know, a little group where you go in and they give you some improvisational speaking thing and you just have to speak on it and you have no preparation or anything. It's just really off the cuff speaking. I was terrified of that when I first started, but I've been doing it for 25 years. So now I can sit in front of you, talk in a podcast. I'm not saying that it's incredibly well delivered, because it's not scripted really. I don't have time to script all this stuff out, storyboard it, whatever, premeditate it, study it copiously. I do study it a lot, obviously. But the point being is that I need to learn how to speak from my heart in front of you and not, and I think that's the most natural, fun people to watch anyway, because they're not fake. You know, I mean, I'm going to say stupid things when I'm talking to you, and someone's going to be foolish, and someone I wish I could have gone back and redone, but I'm not going to stop, edit it out, redo it, make sure it's perfect and clean and shiny and all that kind of stuff. Okay, so you must be able to look foolish. Number 11, dead seriousness. Humor not only lightens your load, it also broadens your perspective. Without laughter, the rough and rocky places on the path might be too painful for you to bear. So be able to laugh at oneself clears the vision. It allows you to, it's like a breath of fresh air. And I'm just laughing half the time. I mean, I laugh at myself a lot because I'm so serious, so intense, always have been ever since I was a little guy. And a lot of times my sense of humor gets beat out of me. Like lately, I just really haven't been in a very humorous state, and it's been not good, you know? So I'm trying to find my way back to that. So I'm just telling you, as I'm reading this stuff and I'm talking to you about this, I am knee deep in 30 years at least, maybe 35, because I started this when I was probably 5 or 6 in soccer. I've been on this path my whole life. Most of us have been without being aware of it, but I mean, I've been deliberately on this path. And I have the wounds and the cuts and the abrasions and the, you know, all these things to show for it. But I also have this incredible respect for this concept of the journey and the master's journey. I mean, I can't even tell you. And if you embark on it, it will be the best thing you probably ever did in your life. I mean, the things you'll get from it far outweigh whatever skill you're trying to obtain. So be able to laugh. Inconsistency, number 12. We're almost done here. Consistency of practice is the mark of the true master. A state of happy concentration called flow. Stripping their minds of outside concerns and focusing their attention fully on the task at hand. Inconsistency not only loses your practice time, loses you practice time, but makes it that much more difficult when you do get around to practicing. So inconsistency, these ups and downs, and you know, it's hard to, you gotta get in a flow state. If you're always only drawing for 30 minutes, I tell people, I go, your dexterity is gonna get better, but you're not gonna remember anything, and you're not really gonna be, you know, getting a lot out of your studying other than better dexterity. But you're not, you're just still gonna be copying everything because you don't have the chance to really design it because you don't know it. So we have to really work on that. So the path of mastery takes many twists and turns and calls for a certain flexibility of strategy and action. Consistency is the essence. Foolish consistency, as Ralph Waldo Emerson puts it, is the hobgoblin of little minds. And I've heard that many times, but that was a good place to put that. Okay, so the 13th one is perfectionism, the last one. Perfectionism, okay? Some of you are gonna be perfectionists. That is a very difficult personality type. A lot of people think of it as a good personality type, and it is in certain ways. You wanna be particular with your endeavors. You wanna be particular with each, every little step of every little thing that you do, but you can get so much so that you can't see the forest for the trees. So we set such high standards for ourselves that neither we nor anyone else could ever obtain them. Nothing is more destructive to creativity than this. Mastery is not about perfection. It is about a process, a journey. The master is one, as we have said so many times before, that stays on the path day in and day out, year after year. The master is one who is willing to try and fail and try again for as long as he or she lives. It's about making mistakes. It's about giving your best effort and giving a conscientious effort. But when the effort has to be so perfect that we can't even make it, then we've already lost. We've already failed because we are unwilling to even take the chance, which gets back to vanity, gets back to some of the other, it shoots back to some of the other ones we talked about previous. So perfectionism, although it has its place, is gonna need to be tempered. And if you are a true perfectionist, the path to mastery will be even more challenging for you, in my opinion. You know, conscientious, not perfectionist, if possible. Okay, so we've covered those 13. Now, in closing, we have a little thing called mastering the commonplace and then closing comments. So we're wrapping it up here with some little inspirational, you know, Zen quotes and stuff. So every Zen master will tell you, building a stone wall or washing dishes is essentially no different from formal meditation. The quality of a Zen student's practice is defined as much by how he or she sweeps the courtyard as by how he or she sits in meditation. Could all of us reclaim the lost hours of our lives by making everything, the commonplace along with the extraordinary, a part of our practice? Because most of life is found in between. It's the in-between times when most of your life transpires. And we'll get into this in some other podcasts that I'd like to touch on. Eckhart Tolle's Power of Now would be one of them. A couple other ones that I've come to mind as I'm talking about that. But the threads that join your every act, your every thought, are infinite. All paths of mastery eventually merge and lead to one. I know these get cryptic and a little bit philosophical and kind of heidi-flighty here at the end. I mean, more, you know, I don't know, new agey, whatever you want to call it. But it's good stuff if you can just, you know, really bear with me. Jigoro Kano, I can't pronounce the name. He's a Japanese judo, the founder of judo, was quite old and close to death. He called his students around him and told them he wanted to be buried in his white belt. How humble is the world's highest ranking judoist in his last days to ask for the emblem of the beginner? At the moment of death, the ultimate transformation, we are all white belts. If death makes beginners of us, then so does life, again and again. So for all of you who will walk the path of mastery, however far that journey has progressed, Kano's request becomes the lingering question and ever new challenge. Are you willing to wear your white belt? So that's a great way to end it. Are you willing to have the beginner's mind, the mind of a fool that just starts on the journey, and to hold that the whole time through the journey? And at the end of the journey, to realize that the beginning was really the end was really the beginning. These get into really ethereal concepts, but I think you'll find that in the long run, it is what it is. You know, what is. So I hope you enjoyed my take on George Leonard's book, Mastery. And I would highly encourage that you pick it up and read it. Read it numerous times over the course of many years. Read it once a year. Make a goal around the new year or something to read it again and ask yourself what you've learned about these concepts throughout that previous year. Many of these books will have to be done that way. They won't be a simple one read. I've read this book probably four times before I did the notes on it to do this presentation. And when I did the notes to do the presentation, it's as if I'd never even read it. I mean, I was like, oh man, I forgot about the parable about the four horses. Oh man, the white belt thing, that was really cool. I totally remember that. It came back to me. But man, I mean, had I not done that, the chances of me having taken that information and being able to absorb it and apply it in my everyday life, although I've been doing it for so long that it's kind of become intuitive, would have been very difficult. So just remember, these books are meant to be read many times along with your course of action on the online school or elsewhere. You have to continue to repeat. Taking head drawing one time, 10 weeks, is not going to cut it. You'll need that class 10 times over 5 to 10 years with the same instructor, same structure to master it. And that'll be anatomy, and that'll be perspective, and that'll be all the things that you study. Get used to it, relax, get on the journey, use these tools, and hopefully it will help. This is a sequence I'm doing on training, and it plays into setting up a schedule for yourself, picking the right instruction. So all these will be ultimately a package that you can watch that will hopefully help direct your energies with intelligence and fashion your thoughts to fruitful issues. Okay? So good luck, keep pushing play, and I'll talk to you soon. Take care.